As you may know, the nervous system is made up of billions of neurons that are connected to one another, such as the one you see here, forming what we call a neural circuit or neural network. It's how we transmit information from our environment up to our brains and back out to our organ systems to adapt and respond to our surroundings. The big question is, how do neurons communicate with one another? Furthermore, how does a single neuron send signals across long distances? We know that some neurons have axons that project over distances that can be over a meter in length. How exactly are neurons able to send information across these distances within milliseconds? Well, you may have heard that the nervous system sends messages using electricity. So what exactly does this mean? It turns out that along the axon of a neuron, information is transmitted using positively charged ions that move across the cell membrane. In order to understand how these ions are able to move across the membrane, we first must learn about a concept called the membrane potential. As its name suggests, the membrane potential has to do with the cell membrane. Remember, the cell membrane separates the extracellular from the intracellular fluid. If we take a close look at the composition of these two compartments, we'll see that there are different concentrations of sodium, potassium, and chloride ions. There are other ions that are present, but these three are the most important in this context. We know that because there are different concentrations of these ions on both sides of the membrane, we have a gradient, but not just any gradient. It's what we call the electrochemical gradient, since all of these ions carry a charge. It turns out that we can measure and even calculate how all these ion gradients interact, which gives us the membrane potential. If you want to know more, take a look at the Nernst equation and the Goldman equation. The membrane potential is measured in millivolts, a unit of measurement you've probably heard of in other contexts. It turns out that the resting membrane potential in neurons is about negative 70 millivolts. When I say resting, this means that the neuron is not sending any information and is in its natural state. Therefore, it is at rest. It turns out that all the cells in your body have a resting membrane potential and can vary based on the composition of the intracellular and extracellular fluid. Some of you might be thinking, why is it so negative? Why isn't the resting membrane potential at a neutral zero? Well, there are a few factors to consider. First, like I mentioned before, there is an unequal distribution of charged particles on both sides of the membrane. In this image, you will see that sodium and chloride have a higher concentration on the outside than on the inside of the cell. Conversely, potassium has a higher concentration on the inside compared to the outside. Second, it turns out there are negatively charged molecules such as DNA and protein that are stuck inside the cell that also make the resting membrane potential more negative. Third, the membrane has protein channels that are open and leak out potassium ions out of the cell. Remember, there is a high concentration of potassium ions inside the cell and a low concentration of potassium ions outside the cell. If we apply what we know about gradients, we know that potassium will move out of the cell if there is an appropriate channel. But wait a second. Remember that these potassium ions are positively charged. So when it leaves the cell, the inner part of the membrane becomes more negative, leading to a more negative resting membrane potential. But wait, if these channels are constantly leaking potassium ions out of the cell, won't all the potassium ions inside run out of the cell? It turns out that neurons have a sodium-potassium pump that uses ATP to move potassium back into the cell against the gradient. These pumps are constantly at work throughout your billions of neurons to maintain the resting membrane potential. It's no wonder that the nervous system is one of the main consumers of ATP. But let's get back on topic. So let's review what we've learned so far. First, neurons communicate through electrical signals. Second, the electrical signals are actually the movement of charged ions like sodium and potassium. Third, the electrochemical gradient, i.e. the unequal distribution of these ions, is what allow these ions to move. Fourth, the electrical Electrochemical gradient can be measured. It's what we call the membrane potential. Lastly, the movement of ions across a cell membrane can alter the membrane potential. Let's take a look at an example. Here we see a neuron membrane and it's at rest, meaning it has negative 70 millivolts for its membrane potential. I've added the concentration of all of the ions I mentioned on the inside and on the outside of the cell. So what do you think would happen to the membrane potential if protein channels permeable to sodium ions were to suddenly open? Would it increase, decrease, or stay the same? To get you started, think about which direction will the sodium ions move. Next, keep track of the charges. If you said the membrane potential will increase, you got it. When the sodium ion channels open, the sodium ions move down its concentration gradient and rushes into the cell. This makes the inner membrane more positive, therefore increasing the membrane potential. Okay, now let's try this again with potassium. What would happen to the membrane potential if protein channels specifically permeable to potassium were suddenly to open? Would it increase, decrease, or not change the membrane potential? If you said the membrane potential will decrease, you got it. When potassium ion channels open, potassium moves down its concentration gradient and rushes out of the cell. This makes the inner membrane more negative as positively charged ions are leaving the cell, therefore decreasing the resting membrane potential. Well, it turns out that changes in membrane potential have special terminology. When the membrane potential increases above its resting membrane potential, we call this depolarization. When the membrane potential decreases below its resting membrane potential, we call this hyperpolarization. With that, it looks like we are ready to talk about how neurons send messages down its axon.